All right, so we are live according to Twitch. This is our first live coding session Twitch stream for Toradex. This is something we're experimenting with. We think there's a place in between the formal documentation and some of our webinars and things for just kind of the ability to get in, start playing with the embedded Linux platform that is Torizon, to just kind of get ideas of how you use it and be able to do some things. So with any luck, this will be an ongoing series. I think our plan is about once a month we'll do this for about an hour. And I don't have a whole lot of content mapped out beyond the first couple sessions, because my hope is that as we have people joining, watching the stream, interacting with me, coming up with ideas on things that we can do, and eventually we want to actually develop, you know, real applications with Torizon, so we start to see some of the workflows that developers will be using. You know, this first session is mainly, you know, I think we called it Hello World. This is, you know, the basic getting started on Torizon. We'll go into some of the architecture. Generally, I don't plan to have slides or anything really firmly pre-prepared, other than, you know, some general outlines of things that I'm planning on covering. So for those that are viewing the sessions, if you have thoughts or feedback on what would be good topics to cover, you know, feel free to speak up. If you're watching live and you have a question and you think there's a good tangent we should explore, I'm all for that. So that's really the whole point of this is to not be too prepared, you know, just kind of start doing things so viewers can see the starts and stops that we have when developing these kinds of systems. So for this first session, I did want to start with kind of an overview of what Torizon is, just to kind of give you the background of why we do things the way we're doing them, how it differs maybe from some other setups that you have done in the embedded space. So, you know, I'm not trying to do a big marketing pitch here. I'm really wanting to talk about the architecture. So Torizon is an embedded Linux system that we have designed around, you know, connected embedded devices. So, you know, obviously it focuses on the Toradex hardware. But the idea is to go a bit beyond what we have delivered in the past, which was primarily focused on board support level and basic reference images. So now we have Torizon, and Torizon is a full platform. It's the operating system that runs on the embedded clients as well as the platform components. I'm not going to get into the platform components this time. That's a topic for the next session. But just briefly, those are things like over-the-air updates, device monitoring. We will be adding other things such as wider fleet monitoring and things like that to help you design your systems and be able to deploy them to the field and be able to you know, keep an eye on your system as a whole. But Torizon itself, the Torizon core operating system, is an embedded Linux system built with the Yocto project. It's an opinionated stack, whereas our previous Yocto reference images were we focused on mechanism, not policy. So we wanted to provide the base board support and allow end users to develop whatever systems were appropriate for them, you know, and make all the decisions themselves. With Torizon, we're actively making more decisions about what goes in the base operating system. So things like systemd, of course, are required. And then if you want to be part of the Torizon platform and get access to the cloud-based connectivity that it offers, things like the actualizer, OTA client, things like that. You don't need to worry too much about the details on that just now, but bear in mind that you know, the whole point of Torizon is to go one step further in terms of providing policy into the system and providing what we like to call an opinionated stack. So there's really a couple of viewpoints from the Torizon platform. What you're seeing here on the screen kind of shows the developer view. some of the things that we try to include, which is where we're going, heading into today, is developer IDE integration with Visual Studio Code and Visual Studio, allowing you to easily focus on your application development and not have to spend a lot of time messing around with building up a Linux system from scratch. You can jump into the IDE, which we will do here in just a few minutes, and say, create me a new Python app, and it knows all the details of how to connect to the board and deploy the application, so you don't have to worry about that complexity. You just write your code, hit the start debug button, and you're doing source level debug. And the other component that we tend to focus on is the operations side of things, so the monitoring and control. And this is related to some of the cloud components that we're not going to dig into too much today. This is where the OTA updates and the device monitoring and fleet monitoring components come in. We'll get into those in a later session, I believe. And so the idea here really is to plug this into kind of a modern DevOps style of rapid iteration, being able to deploy changes quickly to your entire device fleet, being able to deploy security updates as they come out, and that kind of thing. So just briefly, if you're familiar with the Yocto project, the one of the first complaints that people have about the Yocto project, hello, Mr. Micro Hobby, welcome. Glad to see that people are starting to trickle in. That's awesome. One of the first complaints people hear about the Yocto project is that it's a steep learning curve. And there is. I've been doing Yocto for 12 years now, and every day I realize how much more there is to the Yocto project that I know nothing about. So all the complexity is there for very good reasons, but getting started and spending, with something like Torizon, you're able to actually focus on your application and your value add to the system, and not have to worry about being an embedded Linux systems developer. The other thing that I will point out, if you do decide to use Torizon, is we do distribute Torizon, the operating system, as a binary that you can just run, so you don't have to do the full source level builds and things like that you would normally be doing with Torizon. With a Yocto based system, but you can. If you need to go back, it's all open source. All our Yocto layers are MIT licensed. They're available on our GitHub. If you need to do your own custom build, then that is certainly feasible. If you use our binaries as is, of course, you're getting the benefit of our full testing and everything that and maintenance over the life of your product by using our operating system binary. In the base operating system, it's intended to be a very minimal system. As I mentioned, it's based on Yocto. It's running systemd and a few other components. It's got the over-the-air update client. It's got the fleet monitoring client. It has network manager and a few other infrastructure type things in the base operating system. But then it also has the Docker container runtime. And the expectation with application development within the Torizon system is that your apps live in containers for the most part. If you want to go back to Yocto, you can, but you don't need to. If you're familiar with Docker at all on the desktop web cloud space, it's the same Docker with all the features of Docker Hub and all the things you see the icons for over here. As long as there is an ARM-based container for whatever service you're looking for on the Docker Hub, you can download it and run it in your Torizon system. So we're going to start playing with that here in just a bit. But it's important to note that this application architecture is obviously well vetted. Docker is used in a lot of places. We use Docker Compose. We use Docker Compose to give you a multiple service view of things. Very common to have multiple services in a Docker containerized application. One very common thing you'll see is you would have a web front end written in whatever your JavaScript framework of choice is in one service. A second service could be the second service would be like your web server Nginx, and the third service would be your database giving the data persistence. So that's a very common approach. We also have we provide reference containers because one of the complications that a lot of people deal with when working with containers is getting access to hardware, especially when you're talking about graphics and accelerated graphics and that kind of thing. That can be complicated. We have reference containers showing how to do that so that you're able to run Wayland and other things with proper graphics acceleration, getting access to whatever hardware you need from within the container. It's fairly straightforward. It's all part of Docker. It's just a matter of getting it set up and configured properly in the base Docker containers. So let's jump in. First thing I want to do is if we come over here and we take a look, we've got a board here. This is an Apalis i.MX 6. I've got it running our Toradex Easy Installer, which is our mechanism for getting the initial program loaded up and running on the system. I was trying my Ubuntu system you're seeing here is actually a virtual machine, and I ran into some complexities related to virtual machine USB device sharing that wouldn't allow me to boot this directly in recovery mode. So when you buy a brand new board, it comes with the Easy Installer installed. If you have installed a different operating system on your board, you may have some issues. You may need to get back to the Easy Installer, and we have a recovery mode mechanism where essentially you short a couple pins on the board when you power it up, and it comes up in a USB gadget mode, connects to the PC, and you're actually able to inject a memory image into the RAM of the device and run it from there. That had some complexities that didn't work too well with my virtual machine setup here, so I just went ahead and booted it ahead of time into the Toradex Easy Installer. So the very first thing we're going to do is we're going to connect to this board, and we're going to actually install the base Torizon Core operating system. Now, one thing I'm not sure how many people that are familiar with Easy Installer are aware of is that when it boots, it actually sets up a USB Ethernet device to your system. So if we come over here and we look at USB Ethernet and we look at the settings, we see that we have an Ethernet on the 192.168.11 subnet, and this is actually giving me direct connectivity to the board without necessarily having the board connected up to a wired Ethernet. In this case, I happen to have the board connected up to wired, but I can actually access the board at that 192.168.11 address. So if I ping, you see that we have that board. And the other thing is, obviously I have a display on here so you can see the Easy Installer user interface, but it also shares that screen over VNC. So I'm going to go ahead and connect to my VNC here. In this case, I set it up previously. I'm actually using the Ethernet address, but either way, I could have used the 192.168.11 address as well, and that works just fine. In this case, I've got feeds. I've got the normal Toradex image server and our third-party image server. Actually, don't need third-party images now, so we'll turn that off just to simplify. Now it's going to go refresh. And in this case, I'm going to go ahead and install Torizon Core. Now, you note that this says with evaluation containers and upstream. Those upstream is relevant for i.MX 6. So in this case, we're using essentially the kernel.org BSP for this board. We install the system with evaluation containers. So I'll go ahead and start the installation here. This will take just a few minutes. And while that is happening, going to jump over here, and I've got, I believe, a USB serial that's connected to the board. Yes, I do. So I'm going to run PicoCom, my favorite serial terminal program, at 115.200, and then dev tty USB 0, so we can see what's going on. Okay, and this VM is freshly installed, so I get to install things here. Question in the chat, what are the penalties for using containers on embedded systems? The overhead of containers is fairly low. There is certainly some storage overhead because potentially, when you run containers, the idea of a container is to package up the your app with all its dependencies. So you don't have to worry about what version of the C library is provided by the base operating system. You're actually running a fully all-inclusive set of containers with all the dependencies built in. So if you need a specific version of a specific library, it's included in your container. If I then run a different container alongside of it that maybe depends on a different version, very conveniently, the containers will allow that, but obviously we have the overhead now of having two copies of this thing. So there is the storage overhead. Docker is very good, though. It has a layering system built in. It's very good about sharing common components and deduplicating things. So if I have two containers that depend on the same version of the C library, I won't have two copies of it. So in terms of runtime overhead, there's a small overhead at the initialization of the containers, but at runtime, they're standard Linux processes with just some extra flags set in the task control block and allowing them to be scheduled by the standard Linux scheduler. So there's really no runtime overhead, as it were, for the containers themselves. Obviously, if you're running, you can still have thrashing and things like that you would have in a regular non-containerized workload. So there's still optimizations that you can do, but it's really about the separation and the packaging and delivery is what the main benefits of the containers are. Okay, so now we see that I am unable to access the device node. So now I need to add myself to the dial-out group. Let's see. So, okay, dash A is append, add group dial-out, username, and it has to be done as super user. So now, let's see, new group. No, I don't need that with sudo, so new grp dial out. So normally when you add yourself to a group, you'd have to log out and log back in, but if you use the new group command, this is actually something I just discovered I didn't know existed, at least from within the shell. It has now added me to the dial out group, and if I run my picocom with the proper okay. Okay, so now we're actually connected. You see I've got a shell prompt. This is actually the shell prompt of the Easy installer that's running. So I'm just going to let this finish up. It should be done here in just a minute, and then we can reboot into Torizon and see what the first steps in dealing with a Torizon system are. Excellent. So I'm being told we got a bunch of people on the stream. That's awesome. I've gotten a little bit of feedback on the chat. If you're just joining us and you missed the beginning, we are recording, and it'll be posted somewhere. I love feedback. If you have questions, thoughts, digressions, anything you want me to discuss, I'm trying to keep an eye on the chat, and then I also have some colleagues talking in my ear in case I miss it. So the whole point of these is to these sessions is to really kind of dig into to building interesting applications with Torizon. If you guys have thoughts on what you would like to see, we definitely want that feedback. So please feel free in the chat to reach out to us or reach out to us afterwards. I assume my email address is posted somewhere. If not, it's drew.mosley@toradex.com. Okay, so now we see that the installation is completed. So I will power the machine off. I changed my jumper setting so that it'll boot natively now rather than booting into the recovery mode with the Easy installer. And once it comes back up, we will see the now we start to see Torizon coming up. And as I mentioned, there's reference containers that are installed. So what you'll see is actually the portainer container management system showing on the display. And we will then be able to log in and start doing things. I don't generally use Portainer. It's an okay system, but it's a little bit clunky for me. I'm more of a command line junkie, so I'll spend my time, in the command line. So the system is booted. You see we're at the login prompt. So let's go ahead and log in. By default, the login is Torizon with the username of Torizon, and it's going to immediately make me change my password. Out of the box, we don't enforce any particular password requirements, although we do have a developer website tutorial on how to enforce specific password requirements. I'm going to make it very simple. My secret password. And assuming I typed everything right, it should come back to the prompt. And we see that we're running Linux on a Palace i.MX 6. Okay, so let's see, what can we do here? So we are actually now running Docker is the main way we're going to be running applications. And so you see we have the three reference containers up and running. Just for fun, I'm going to go ahead and stop them. Torizon Kiosk 1, Torizon Weston 1, and Torizon Portainer 1. So now you see that the display has shut off. All right, so let's go ahead and let's just run some containers just for fun. As I said, we'll do the hello world. All right, so it's unable to find it locally. Since I do have an Ethernet connected to this board, it's actually able to download the Hello World app from Docker Hub. If we look at Docker images, obviously we have the ability to see what images we've downloaded, the pre-canned images that are part of the reference images you see there. So, you know, that's the basic get the thing up and get it running. Now we need to see about installing Visual Studio Code and our extension with it. So we will jump over to our web browser, Visual, and just search for it. All right, so in this case, I'm just downloading the Debian package. I know there's I believe there's a snap version. I think that's what I use on my main development system. But in this case, I'm just downloading the Visual Studio Code Debian package directly. And now it's telling me it's not supported. That's interesting. All right, let's download this file. Let's see, RPM, nope, deb. Save it and try from the command line. See if we can figure out what that error was. All right, so I don't know why it was unable to do it through the GUI, but it does seem to be making further progress now on getting Visual Studio Code installed. Okay, so now we have that. So let's go up here to our activities, search for Visual Studio Code. We'll add it to favorite so it stays up on the side. So the first thing you're going to need to do once you've got Visual Studio Code installed is to go over to the extensions marketplace and you're going to search for Torizon. You'll see that there's a couple options here. There's an old Qt Design Studio. We don't want that. And there are two versions of the Toradex Torizon extension. This is the officially released one, I believe, and that's version 1.3. And then this is the early access one. Obviously, this is more of a beta release, has the new features, but hasn't gone through quite as extensive testing. For now, I'm going to go ahead and install the early release. So it's making sure it's got all the dependencies it needs to install, some Docker, another extension related to Docker, and a few other things. So while that is installing and initializing, I'm going to come back over here, and the next step is to install the Torizon Core Builder tool. So if we just search for that, Torizon Core Builder is our tool for allowing you to customize these images. So this allows you to without going back to the Octo build, to be able to make changes such as splash screens, device tree mods, tree kernel drivers, and that kind of thing. So we want to come in here and let's see, where are the instructions for installing? Installing, there we go, that's what I was looking for. And so all we do is download this one script. And Torizon Core Builder actually runs in a Docker container, so do I have Docker installed? Nope, I do not. I don't even have Docker installed on my machine here. So we will go ahead. I thought that was the command, the site. Let's see, I thought there was a release, a shell script I could just download. I must be missing it here. Well, I know that Ubuntu packages a version. In the past, it had some issues. Let's just try, maybe that this is an up-to-date enough version of Docker that we can work with it. Anybody on the chat know for sure? So we'll go ahead and install Docker. I think I'll need to install wget as well. I don't believe I have that installed. Okay, so now we have Docker. We got to do the same thing that we had done earlier by adding me to the group. So group add, append to my group list, group Docker. Oh, what did I get wrong? No, not group add, user mod. Now if we say new group Docker to pull that into my current shell session, I'm able to see that there are no Docker containers running, and I can run a Docker container here on my desktop system. So we've got Docker installed. I think, yeah, oh nope, I do have wget already installed, so I should be able to download the Torizon Core Builder setup. Source that, and it's going to manifest unknown. I need it curl installed. So, as I said at the beginning, the whole point of this is to see all the stops and starts that you're going to have. So these are the kinds of things that you're going to run into when you're building this up. So now we're actually downloading the Torizon Core Builder Docker container. Obviously, the download only has to happen the first time, but you definitely want to keep that setup script around because you'll want to invoke that before you are when you are running Torizon Core Builder. So now we should have Torizon Core Builder in our path. So there we go. So let's jump back over to this. So it looks like it's still installing. Maybe that's because I didn't have Docker installed. I'm going to exit out and come back into Visual Studio Code. Okay. So it's still checking something. Add Docker to sudo. Well, I didn't have to do that on my desktop for sure. Oh, yeah, that's right, because I added myself, thank you, Micro Hobby, I added myself to the Docker group for that shell. What I'm going to have to do is restart my virtual machine so that the entire shell session, or the entire login session will have that. So let's do that real quick. So yeah, I was trying to use new group to avoid having to do the restart, but no such luck. So let's go back into Visual Studio Code, and let's just make sure I am in the group. Docker, yeah, so I got it in there. So now it looks like we've made some progress. There we go. That's better. Yeah, that's fine. That's expected. Okay, so it's going to bring up the end user license agreement for the NXP software that's part of our build. That's fine. We'll go ahead and close that. Okay, so now that we have a system up and running with the tools that we need, we're going to go ahead and just play with some sample code. Do I have Git installed? I do. Okay, so now we want to do a search for Torizon samples. There's a Git repository that we can clone with a number of sample applications. So if we look in here, you see a number of different applications that we've provided. We'll play with one or two of these maybe a little bit later, but I just wanted to check those out so we had them for reference. Okay, so now we know that we have a board. So we're going to come over here to the Torizon extension, and we're going to add that board to the Visual Studio Code interface here. What did we say the IP address of the board was? So I will. So it's 17.86, so we will go ahead and add our Torizon device here. Asks for the username and our super secret password, and it's going to connect to the board over SSH, and it's going to install an agent on the board that allows it to talk to Torizon. What did I do wrong? Error reading SSH protocol banner. Okay, let's see if I can SSH into the board directly. Okay, so I'm able to connect to the board, so it's not a connectivity issue. What did I, maybe I typed it wrong. Ah, there we go. So yeah, so it was finally able to get connected. It's making the connection to the board now. It's going to install the agent if it's able to log in, and then it'll reboot the board, and we will, so now we see the board rebooting. And in a moment, once it finishes rebooting, we'll actually start to see details about the board here in our IDE. Okay. So now the board's up and we're actually able to see details. So, you know, while we're developing, we can come in here and we can see, okay, what images are on the container. So of course this matches what we saw directly from the command line. I can clean up the images that I don't need. I can see what containers are running. This is the hello world that ran and exited, so I can go ahead and remove that so that it's no longer there. We can see a lot more detail about the processes running on the system, just general good information about what we might need. If we select the machine directly, you see all this inventory information about the board down here. So that's the basic connectivity. So let's go ahead and jump in and we'll do our fun Hello World Python app. So Control-Shift-P brings up the command window, and maybe that's, yeah, Torizon Python create Python application. So we'll call this hello as normal. We'll put it just in our documents directory. That sounds good. It's a Python 3 console application. This is a ARM32, and the username is Torizon. So yes, I trust the authors because I'm writing it. So now this is getting set up for doing actual Python development. So all the complexities of the container setup and everything are being hidden from us by the extension. So we'll get the Python extension installed and some of the other dependent things, and then we will be able to get back to our application. So if we come back up here to our folder, see we've got our main.py. Don't really need to write any code. It's already set up for us. So in this case, simply hitting, I believe it's F5, will start. It will build the image, including all the dependencies. Now, this is where knowledge of the containers can come in handy. You see apt-update. So this is installing dependencies in a Debian-based container for running Python. So we provide reference containers as a Debian base that you can start with. Obviously, if you're running a Python application, you'll need to install Python. So the extension handles that all for you. As we add functionality to the apps, we may have to manually add some things. So we'll take a look at that here in just a few minutes after we get past the initial Hello World setup. So this takes a few minutes the first time through, but it's generating the container image, and then it's going to push it directly to the board over SSH. It's going to start up the container, start the application, and set it up for a remote debug. Although I haven't set a breakpoint yet. Let's see, can I put a breakpoint in while it's doing all this? And hopefully it will stop at that breakpoint. It's continuing to install some of the dependencies. Now it's deploying the image to the board. And since this is a console app, we don't really need to see much about the on the display. There won't be anything interesting shown there. So if we expand this, we can see a little bit more detail. So now you see that it's loading layer. So this is a Docker thing. This all these checksums here, that's the layering mechanism that I mentioned early on, that's part of Docker. So we're actually deploying, you see all the layers that are part of this that are being deployed to the board. Just for fun, we can come over here. So you see that it's running the program, running from the board. If I just say Docker PS, you see that we have another Docker container running. See this long automatically generated name telling us the details about it. So we're actually running, and you see we've hit our breakpoint here. It automatically brings up the debug console. So if we go ahead and just step through, you can see source level debug, and you also see the console output application. Okay, so what next? So obviously Hello World is nice and all, okay, I'm told that there's some issues with the stream. Is anybody else having issues only seeing part of the screen? All right, let's just switch back to this view. Hopefully that's good. That should just be the screen of my virtual machine coming through. Okay, so we'll just stick with this. I don't know what happened there, but anyway. So yeah, obviously running Hello World is not terribly interesting. I did mention the Docker containers. Let me pull up this link. Oh, that's actually a subdirectory here. So as I mentioned, we have Debian containers that we provide that you can easily create a new container from. Probably will deal with that more in the next instantiation of this live coding session in terms of how do you create custom containers. For now, I did want to do a little bit more with some of these sample apps that we have here. This will be fun. I haven't actually run these in quite a while, so I'm sure there will be issues. So let's take a look here. One I wanted to look at was this weather app. So if we take a look here, it's a multi-container C++ app with a database and a chart plot tool. And just for fun, I will bring up the Docker Compose file. So you see in here, this is the ability to set up a multiple service environment. So in here we get Grafana, which is a visualization tool. We got InfluxDB, and then we've got some code that's actually pulling weather information. And there's details that you can read about in the Docker Compose documentation in terms of networks. So this is how each of the services can communicate with each other or communicate with other devices. Volumes, in this case, we are specifying a couple volumes for persistent data. Just for fun, what we will do is try to run this on the board. I'm not sure. Do I have Git on the board? I do not. So I need to somehow transfer this file over to the board. So we will create a directory for it. So for now, I'm just going to do this all by hand. Ultimately, we would want to do this through Visual Studio Code, but I'm going to just do it by hand for now. Okay. Actually, no, I am incorrect. That's not going to work here. Let's see. How am I going to do this? Okay, so looks like the easiest way is to just follow the README and build it here. We'll build it. That's not right. So in this case, I'm actually building from my development system, and it's set up to build for 32-bit containers. Okay, so this is obviously a by hand version of some of the things that the Visual Studio Code extension will do. In this case, we're actually creating an updated Docker image, which I'll actually push to my Docker Hub. Okay, so now we see a lot of the same kind of things we saw with the Hello World app. Now we're just seeing at the command line, Docker Compose is pulling all the dependencies in for that are specified for this particular application. Oh boy. Okay. That's just a warning. For our purposes, it can be safely ignored. So now we're actually building our InfluxDB application that's going to be part of this Docker Compose setup. Now we're on to building another one of the services, so we're going to be basing it on a particular upstream GitHub Docker repository. Okay, so now, but I do need to rename. I need to rebuild it and tag it with my user ID on Docker Hub so that I can push it to my space on there on Docker Hub. So we'll just call it Drew Mosley Weather Latest. Is that not the right? Oh, nope. Oh, I see. Yeah. All right, let's see what images we have, what images were created. Okay, so the images are created, so weather. Can I I'm not sure how to associate with this image with my account now the way it was built, so I will have to play with that come back to that on our next stream. So the next thing, I'm going to go ahead and skip on this because I'm missing some steps here and it's going to take a little bit longer than I'd like to get it figured out. But the next thing I wanted to do was actually do a little bit more interesting Python application. This actually came up from some discussions with some users who were trying to figure out, okay, how the heck do I connect these boards to Wi-Fi or networking. Now, obviously, with a wired network, generally it's DHCP, it all comes up automatically, but if you want to deal with Wi-Fi, you need some ability to provide credentials. Now, the simplest mechanism is from within the board itself is to use, I believe it's NMCLI, which is the Network Manager CLI, to scan for devices and to be able to attach. But that's not terribly, that doesn't really fit into the application model of Torizon as an application stack. So what after doing some research, I figured out that probably the best approach is to use the dbus interface to Network Manager, and from within a container, we can actually use the Network Manager API over dbus to configure Network Manager. And so I was doing a little bit of searching and I found some ready-made examples, which is kind of nice. Network Manager API examples. Let's see, dbus Python examples. That's exactly the one I wanted. And so there's a few apps here. So let's go ahead. And so the first thing I'm going to do, and whenever I start working on an application, normally I'm going to start at the command line on the Torizon system. I won't necessarily automatically start inside the Visual Studio code, just to kind of get a feel for what's next, for what is needed for this particular application. So that's not one. I want to check what the active access point is on this device. So that would be this Python code here. I'm not terribly familiar with the dbus API, but looking through this code, it's not terribly complicated. So let's come over here. Now, we're going to want to run in a container. So let's just run this in an Ubuntu container because I'm familiar with that setup. So docker run Ubuntu. And so this will download the latest Ubuntu container and launch Ubuntu for me to experiment in. So this will take just a moment, and then I'll be at an Ubuntu shell prompt, and I'll be able to use apt to install things. I know I'll need to install Python, and there are a few other dependencies which we'll figure out as we go. So this is kind of, you know, when you're building a containerized application like this and you're working with external sources or external containers that you don't necessarily know all the requirements of, this is kind of how I start to get a sense for what the requirements are, what we're going to need to set up in Visual Studio Code to allow these containers to run. So we will go ahead and copy this entire source. I will probably need to install wget inside the container because it's not installed, if I remember right, it's not installed by default. And the downside of doing it this way is all my changes are lost when I exit the container. So all these downloads and things we'll have to do again if we have to exit the container and come back in. So go ahead and get wget. In fact, I know I'm going to have to exit and come back in, so I'm just going to exit out of that. We'll come back in and redo all this. So the one thing I did not do is I need to map as a volume the var, I think it's var run dbus, which is where the socket is for dbus communications with the host OS. So if I add a volume, so that it's mapped in the same place, and I run my Ubuntu container again. Now if I look at var run dbus inside the container, I'm actually looking at the socket for the host container, and of course this is what's going to allow me to communicate with the dbus instance for network manager that's running on the host. So we'll go ahead and apt update again. And then we'll need to install wget. I know I'll need Python, and I know I will need the Python dbus library, so we'll install all those. This will take a minute to get these packages installed. And so these are the kinds of pieces of information that we'll need for creating a project in Visual Studio for this. We know we needed Python, Python dbus. Wget is just convenience. We don't really need it. I'm using it for doing this work by hand. And obviously my serial terminal's having issues. This would be a little bit easier to follow if I was logged in over SSH. I believe at some point it's going to ask me about time zones, so hopefully we can get that figured out. just set a. I have no idea what time zone I just set, but shouldn't matter for experimentation purposes. Okay, so looks like we're about done. There we go. Okay, good. So we have Python installed. We have wget installed. Let's go ahead and download our source file. So now we have our source file here, and let's just try to run it, see what happens. Okay. Oh, and I know what I did wrong. Okay, so we need, obviously, access to the host networking stack to be able to do these kinds of things. So we'll have to exit out. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to SSH in so I don't have that line wrapping issue. Okay, so what was the command exactly? Run-v. So the next thing I want to do is I want to specify host networking. So normally, Docker creates separate bridges and things like that for each of the containers to run on. And from within the container, you can't see the host networking stack. But if you specify dash net host, or maybe it's dash dash net, well, I guess we'll find out when I try to run the thing. Then from within the Docker container, you actually have access to the host networking, which is obviously going to be needed if we're trying to configure Network Manager here. So we'll go ahead and run. Oh, I guess it is dash dash net. Okay, so now I don't think ifconfig is installed. I don't think IP is installed. So let's go ahead and do our apt install stuff. Oh, and my dog is trying to participate here in the call. I guess that's live streaming for you. So obviously having to redo this every time is a little bit annoying. There are certainly things you can do in Docker to make that not happen, but since I'm just experimenting for now, I think it's okay. So we install wget python 3 python 3 dbus, and let's see, what were the package names? I'm looking on my desktop to make sure I get the right package names. Okay, so I'm also going to install the packages iputils-ping and net-tools. Yep, so we'll go ahead and let all that get installed. And while that's going, I'm going to come back over here and we'll go ahead and start up we'll just reuse this existing project. We'll go ahead and copy and paste our sources here. Just completely overwrite that. Now, we know we need Python. That's installed by default. We don't need to explicitly add that. But we know also that we'll need the Python 3-dbus library. So we'll come down here to Torizon. Let's see, extra packages is in here somewhere. So we're going to specify python3-dbus. And we'll just try to build this. I think we may need to specify something a little bit different. Task. So while that's running in the background, now we've got all our packages installed. We'll go ahead and just manually download this. Now if we run ifconfig, you see we have access to all the host networking stack, networking interfaces. Now this is in a Palace i.MX6, which does not have built-in Wi-Fi. So I'm going to connect my USB Wi-Fi. Is it there and I just missed it? Not seeing my Wi-Fi? It was yesterday. Nope. Let's see what happens if I disconnect it and disconnect and reconnect. Wi-Fi USB device. All right. I've got a different model here. Let's see if I can find the right USB device. There we go. So that one is recognized as a USB device. So from the base OS, if I run ifconfig, we should have, I believe it's called WLAN0. Okay, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it's not being recognized. We're missing firmware for that one. Okay, let's see. I think I've got a third one here. One of these is bound to work. Okay, that looks better. Okay, so now we have a wireless interface. And also back from within the container, we have a wireless interface. So we're not connected to anything. Oh, and it's not Python, it's Python 3. So our Python code, it was able to determine that WLAN0 is not currently associated with any Wi-Fi. And similarly, if we come in here We have the Wi-Fi, what's it called? List devices. Is it add connection? I think this might be the one. No, that's an Ethernet. Oh, Wi-Fi PSK. So this is the one here. So now we have this, and I have to go turn on my test network. Input all my 2FA codes here for my network management. Okay, so now that's enabled. So remember right for this application, we need to actually edit it, and so I'll install Nano real quick, and we can edit this file and insert the credentials and connect. Wi-Fi and my secret password. So if you're outside my house, you can connect now. So now it's created the connection, and if we come back over here to the takes a minute. So while that's connecting, let's jump back over here. We got just a few minutes left. Let's jump back over to what is our exception? Failed to connect to socket. Ah, yes, so this comes down to that volume that I had to create manually when I ran the app from hand, so or by hand, I should say. So if we come back over here, we set up a volume for var run dbus, and it maps to var run dbus. And the other thing I need to do for this app, this is the one that prints what we're connected to. I need to add app args, tell it is WLAN 0 that we want to. Go ahead and start it again, come back over here, and we're still not connected. I wonder why. Oh, for some reason it doesn't realize that it's Wi-Fi. I guess you'll have to take my word for it. I did this before, and it does work. So, but the point is not, in this case, necessarily to figure out one specific application. So in this case, you know, you see that we've actually run that app to show what we're connected to, and we get the same output, obviously. But now we've actually got this in an actual Visual Studio Code project with the dependency specified so that, you know, we're able to actually save these files off into source control, and this is the beginning of our project. Now we can start to write the other components of our project. If we need other services, say we need a C# app, you know, we would create a Torizon C# app, and you know, we see which ones we have: .NET, ASP.NET, Python, CC++, and then we can also, and this is a fairly new feature, there is a Torizon Core Builder. We can create a project for customizing the image. So this will create the basic Torizon Core Builder app. Torizon Core Builder configuration, which we're able to then, you know, specify the things that we're going to be changing in the base image and that kind of thing, and create our own custom image. But we'll get into to more of that next time. So it turns out, I guess there were two things that failed today that I'm going to figure out for next time. One is how to get that weather app working, and two is what's going on with my Wi-Fi, where it's not being recognized as a Wi-Fi. I'll get some details for that. I think we're a little bit over time from the original planned hour. Nice thing is we got a little bit flexibility. I want to thank everybody for coming. If you got any questions, now's the time to get them in the chat. Otherwise, please feel free to reach out. You know, I definitely want feedback and questions and comments from anybody that is interested. So with that, I will thank you all for coming, and we will send out details on when the video is up if anybody wants to follow through and catch up on anything they might have missed the first time around. Thank you very much.